Next item of business is a statement by Kate Forbes on Prestwick Airport. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Kate Forbes, up to 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to make a statement on the conclusion of the most recent sales process for Glasgow Prestwick Airport and our ambitions for the business going forward. Parliament was updated on the decision to retain the business in public ownership on the 21st of December last year, but I'm aware that it remains a topic of interest, so wish to provide as much information as I'm able to. Let me say at the outset that we've been clear since acquisition of the business that it does remain our intention to return it to the private sector at the appropriate time. That position has not changed, nor has our commitment to securing a long-term future for the business, which would have ceased to operate in 2013 without intervention. In recognition of the legitimate interest in the future of the business, I'll provide a timeline of the most recent sales process. We received a credible expression of interest in acquisition of the business in November 2020. Any commercial process like this benefits from competition, and so, following receipt of the expression of interest, we invited further bids on the open market. We were encouraged that the process attracted three potential bidders who met our eligibility criteria. In summary, our eligibility criteria were that the business should continue as an operational airport, that bidders should develop and maximise the economic benefits and employment potential associated with the business, and that bidders should demonstrate strong financial capability and the ability to achieve their proposed plans for Glasgow Prestwick Airport. One of the three potential bidders withdrew at an early stage, and two bids were subsequently received and evaluated with input from independent legal and commercial advisers and support from the management team at the business. A preferred bidder was identified in February 2021, and more detailed negotiations commenced. Commercial confidentiality prevents me from naming these bidders or disclosing the detail of their bids. That is entirely standard practice in a process like this, regardless of whether the parties involved are in the public or the private sector. I know, and I hope certainly, that members will understand that important point. Nor would it be desirable for me to publicly discuss the detail which might prejudice any future negotiation. However, I can say that much of the media speculation in recent weeks has been wholly inaccurate. The commercial negotiation with the preferred bidder was constructive, with both sides committing significant energy and resource to the process of diligence and commercial negotiation. However, in May 2021, the preferred bidder withdrew from the process. For reasons already outlined, I will not get into the detail of the underlying rationale for that decision, save to record that there was mutual agreement that that was the appropriate outcome. That enabled us to re-engage with the second-placed bidder. A revised bid was submitted on the 30th of June 2021 and given detailed consideration. Following detailed analysis over several months, various concerns were identified. Following a clear recommendation from the board, informed by independent advice, I determined that the bid should not be pursued further. Presiding Officer, you will appreciate that these decisions were not taken lightly. However, I wish to be clear that ministers have a long-term commitment to the business. We wish to secure a sustainable future for it, which recognises not just the commercial value in the business itself, but the wider contribution which it makes to the local and the regional economies which it serves. We want to return the business to the private sector, but that must be on the right terms and in the right circumstances. We remain open to any future credible expressions of interest. We are a willing seller, but we're not a distressed seller. And so to the future, the business is performing well. It continues to steadily strengthen its position as a niche airport with a reputation for being innovative and flexible in meeting customers' needs. Significant progress has been made in winning a bigger share of the fixed base operations market. Property around the campus has high occupancy rates. It supports a range of important tenants, including maintenance, repair and overhaul providers and search and rescue. As set out in the business's most recent accounts, a modest profit was achieved in 2020-21. The success of COP26 has been a particular highlight, which showed once again that the business can handle traffic for global events. The entire Prestwick team are to be commended. They rose to the challenge of COP26 and delivered for their customers, further enhancing the reputation of the business globally. Members will recall that both the former chair of Prestwick, Mr. Andrew Miller, and the former chief executive, Mr. Stuart Adams, postponed their planned retirement dates to support completion of the most recent sale process. The sale process having now concluded, both have now retired. But I want to put on record my sincere thanks to both of them for their significant contributions to the business in recent years. I would also like to welcome the newly appointed chair and newly appointed chief executive. Their role is to now build on recent success and drive the business forward so that profitability can be sustained and Glasgow Prestwick Airport can continue to make an important contribution to Scotland's economy. And I look forward to supporting them in that task. As with all parts of the aviation industry, Prestwick faces challenges. Recovery from the pandemic will not be easy, but I'm confident that the business is in a much better shape than when the Scottish Government bought it 8 years ago. We said then that there were no quick fixes, and we stand by our long-term commitment. Presiding Officer, it is in the public interest to see Prestwick succeed. It's in the interest of the staff who work there and other businesses that rely on it to see it succeed. Politicians from all parties have championed Prestwick over the years, and I hope that that support will continue as the business grows in line with the ambitions we have for it. Thank you.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. Can I say from the outset that I firmly believe that Prestwick can be a success, and we all hope for that. Now, the Scottish Government bought Prestwick Airport for £1 in 2013. Nicola Sturgeon said the aim was, quote, turning Prestwick around and making it a viable enterprise. So you have to ask that why, more than 8 years on, has that not happened? What is it that the Scottish Government is looking for from a buyer? What are the various concerns that the Cabinet Secretary referred to from the latest bid? And I'm not asking for figures here. I'm not asking her to betray confidences. The latest accounts show an operating profit of £500,000. That's way down on the previous year. Freight held up, but passenger numbers plummeted, and it may be a while before they recover. So I'm just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary can tell us, what does the operating profit need to get to in order for the airport to be put back on sale? The latest doomed bid, and it was from Train Alliance UK, the Cabinet Secretary doesn't want to say that, it was scuppered when it emerged that major repairs are required to the runway. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm the figure for those repairs was around £20 million? And can she say why the preferred bidders were not told about it and why they were kept in the dark? And if I'm right on that figure, or whatever the figure is the Scottish Government going to pay for those repairs before the airport is put back on sale?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's quite a lot of questions in there, so hopefully you will allow me to just go into some of the detail. In terms of the starting position that the member set out, that he wants Prestwick to be a success, as I do, and he asked a question in terms of the viable enterprise for where profit needed to get to. I would suggest that that's not one of our criteria in terms of looking for bids. We, as I said already, are a willing seller. So, as it were, we will work with any expressions of interest, whether they emerge today, tomorrow or next year. We will work with any expressions of interest. In terms of the financials are strong. So he will have looked at the annual report and accounts published on the 21st of December. He cited the operating profit before exceptional items as being £500,000. The total profit after tax for the year was £12.8 million, which includes technical accounting for non-cash revaluation of assets. And I think overall, that was in a year where every part of the aviation industry really struggled, really was facing huge challenges. He talks about passenger numbers. And, you know, that was not unique to Prestwick. But what Prestwick have been able to do under expert management and the help of the chair and the board is to develop a niche market. So I would caution at saying it's not about the accounts, which I think are showing that this is a successful business that has great opportunity. In terms of the bids, I would again caution by saying that he is citing some of the media speculation, and I would caution again, and I've already said that much of it has been wholly inaccurate. We will obviously continue to respect commercial confidentiality in terms of the specific bidders. But he talked about the condition of the runway, and you know, the reasons for any bidder ending their involvement in the process is a matter for them. But again, I say a lot of the reporting has been inaccurate. And the runway and all other infrastructure at Prestwick is maintained and it's operated in accordance with regulatory requirements. An area next to the runway was the subject of a discussion last year in terms of some damage by a jet blast of a departing aircraft. It's been repaired. So the runway was not damaged in the process. So I hope that's given a comprehensive answer to very comprehensive questions.
I call Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of our statement. It's 10 years since Prestwick was bought by the government, claiming the plan was to return it to the private sector. But a decade on, we still don't have any clear explanation from the Cabinet Secretary why every single appointment by the government of preferred bidders of their choice always ends in the same outcome, which is no sale. We still don't know how close we were this time to an actual sale. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us, of all, apart from the latest bids that she's explained were rejected in the timescale they were rejected, how many other bids have been received by the government since it took ownership in the last 10 years, and when were they rejected? The Cabinet Secretary says that the finances of Prestwick are strong, but obviously there's still no repayment plan for the millions of pounds of government loans, and we know there's a need for significant investment in Prestwick Airport. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us, given the fact we're no further forward when it comes to a new owner, where will that investment come from? Where, Cabinet Secretary, is the government plan for the running of Prestwick Airport to deliver that sustainable future she talked about and securing the jobs that the Ayrshire economy desperately needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the member. In terms of the specific questions that he asked, I mean, I do think that those latest accounts shouldn't be dismissed, because this is a credible business with a credible plan that is proving its success and will continue to be successful. And we will continue to work with the board in particular to develop their strategy for the future of the airport. And just last week, I think, if I remember my diary correctly, I met with the new chair, who is has been appointed with considerable expertise and a vision for Prestwick Airport. So we have a refreshed operating board. We'll work with them. He asked specifically about opportunities to make investment, and they will focus on the development of new revenue opportunities and building on the strengths, and we will continue to engage with them in terms of how we support that work. In terms of the overall bids, I want to emphasise again that the three bids that we received were credible bids. So there are reasons why each bid did not come to fruition. Again, these are complex reasons, and many of them have not been covered in any of the public media speculation. In terms of the bids, I think I went through the timeline for the most recent bids, which I hope helps in that answer.
Siobhan Brown, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for this statement. Can the Cabinet Secretary expand upon the ways in which the eligibility criteria for bidders ensures that the local community in Ayrshire benefit from the sale of Prestwick Airport?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, going back to the criteria did make clear that the long-term continuation of Prestwick as an airport and a key Scottish infrastructure asset was essential. We also required a commitment and capability to operate businesses directly relevant to Prestwick, so including, for example, amongst others, aviation, logistics, infrastructure, real estate, and other services, and bidders were asked to demonstrate their capability and their commitment to developing and maximising the economic benefits and this is key for the local area, and the employment potential associated with the business. That's why we had originally bought Prestwick, and that's why we want to ensure it goes to the right bidder.
Brian Whittle, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The preferred bidder withdrew their initial bid because of the omission from the Prestwick Airport sales prospectus of the state of the runway, and on resubmission of their bid, taking this initial omitted information into account, were so frustrated at the lack of any response from the Scottish Government, they felt they had no option available to them but to approach me and ask me to personally give a hard copy of their bid to the Scottish Government, which I did, to Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson, who said he would pass it on to Kate Forbes. So, Presiding Officer, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary thinks this is the way to work with a business and preferred bidder, and does she think this kind of amateurish approach will encourage any potential future bidder?
Cabinet Secretary.
In terms of the way that we have approached this, we have engaged with all three bidders. So I'm happy to pick up with the member after this conversation in terms of his direct experience. But certainly, I'm not sure that the dates he cites are strictly accurate in terms of when I assumed responsibility for Prestwick and also the times at which certain bidders pulled out.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The leader of North Ayrshire Council's Tory group, Councillor Tom Marshall, has called for Prestwick Airport to be closed. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what the impact on the aerospace industry, Ayrshire economy, local employment and local community would be if this profitable airport was closed down?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's that very clear understanding of the economic impact of closure that caused us to intervene in the first place in 2013. We were very clear that closure would have a significant impact on the local economy, not just because of jobs lost in the airport, but also because of various other businesses that rely on the airport being operational. And those include MRO facilities providing highly skilled engineering jobs. So, you know, Prestwick has always enjoyed cross-party support locally. I think we've heard again today that it enjoys cross-party support, and I hope we can get behind ensuring that not only does it get returned to the private sector, it gets returned to the right bidder and it continues to grow in terms of its success.
Carol Mockin, to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP Government's commitment to fair work is questionable at best, but that a job advert released last year at Scottish Government-owned Prestwick Airport was advertised paying less than the real living wage is simply shocking. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us why, after almost a decade of ownership, does government-owned Prestwick Airport still not pay the real living wage and give its employees, many of whom are within my own South of Scotland constituency, the proper wage they deserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
We expect all employers to pay at least the real living wage and to adopt fair work principles. That expectation has not changed and we are actively engaged in working with all employers, public and private sector employers, to ensure that they meet the standards in our Fair Work First policy.
Eleanor Whittam, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the Scottish Government's recent support of a £4.8 million research and development infrastructure grant towards the development of the new Aerospace Innovation Centre at Spirit Aerosystems in my constituencies to be welcomed, along with the Scottish Government's investment in the Ayrshire Growth Deal, both of which recognise the strategic importance of the aerospace design, innovation, manufacturing, repair businesses and the potential for the spaceport ambitions? And does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this is all contingent on the continued operation of Prestwick Airport?
In short, I'd absolutely agree with Eleanor Whittam on all these points. And the First Minister, as she will know, was delighted to open the new Aerospace Innovation Centre last September, enhancing the excellent capabilities within Spirit Aerosystems and will support greater innovation more broadly across the aerospace cluster at Prestwick. This is one of the obvious immense opportunities and why we're working with the board to ensure that Prestwick gets these opportunities locally.
Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement and for outlining what has happened with the various potential buyers over the last couple of years. We all know that air travel is a small but significant contributor to climate emissions, with emissions rising steadily prior to the pandemic. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether she will include in discussions with future buyers of Prestwick Airport additional eligibility criteria that speak to being a climate-resilient airport, supporting and developing innovative low-carbon air travel technologies and their associated jobs, and reducing, not just offsetting, emissions that result from flights coming through the airport?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will know about the Scottish Government's commitments backed by Parliament to be net zero by 2045. And that means that all parts of Scotland, every sector, has a role to play. And as a publicly owned airport, that would include Prestwick. And so certainly as part of our strategic approach to returning Prestwick to the private sector, I'm sure that will feature in future discussions.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
The SNP Green Government support the expansion of Heathrow Airport with a third runway with an extra 75,000 extra flights for Scotland. Part of the contract between the Scottish Government and Heathrow Airport included the examination of the possibility that Prestwick could be included in the supply chain. So how much of the future of Prestwick Airport is dependent on the expansion of Heathrow Airport?
Cabinet Secretary.
The opportunities for Prestwick Airport are much bigger and far greater than the relationship with Heathrow. I already cited in my opening statement some of the opportunities for Prestwick. They have diversified considerably their operations. They have a stronger business model, and they are continuing to adapt to changing circumstances. We're supportive of the business, and we hope that under this new refreshed leadership, the chair, the board and the chief executive continue to develop that strategy for growth.
I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Edward Mountain. Ms Mackay, I believe you may be on mute. Would you like to check, please? Would you like to begin again? We're having a difficulty at the moment hearing you in the chamber, Ms Mackay, so we will work behind the scenes and hopefully return to you. In the meantime, I call Edward Mountain. Mr Mountain, it seems that we're having a difficulty hearing members joining us remotely in the chamber. We will try to come back to you, so just bear with us just now. I will move on to John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary said a bit about the previous bidding process, and I just wonder if she can say something about the future. As I understood it, she said there was an expression of interest followed by an opening out to bids. So is that broadly how she would see it in the future, that somebody would wait for an expression of interest and then would look for more bids?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we will carefully consider any proposal from credible investors with a positive vision and plan for Prestwick. Until then, obviously, it will continue in government ownership. We've not set any time frame for disposal of the business, and we're not actively marketing it at this stage, immediately after the last expressions of interest. As I said in my opening remarks, we are a willing seller, but we would only do so when the circumstances were right. We are open to credible expressions of interest.
Thank you. My sincere apologies to those members who were joining us remotely that we've been unable to connect with. We will continue to look into this matter. At this moment, we're going to move on to the next item of business. There'll be a short pause as we do so.